Welcome to SEC Baseball Opening Weekend. Tonight in Tuscaloosa, Alabama, we've been delayed an hour by rain, but we're now ready for baseball between the 14th-ranked Alabama Crimson Tide and the 5th-ranked Tennessee Volunteers. Welcome, everybody. I'm Roger Hoover. Glad to welcome you inside the broadcast booth, along with former Crimson Tide star and Major Leaguer Lance Cormier. And Lance, the toughest test in college baseball begins tonight. SEC play for the Crimson Tide and the Vols.
Yeah, you'll hear a lot of it. The gauntlet, right? 10 straight weeks of the best of the best of college baseball. I mean, 9 teams right now ranked in the SEC. And so there's no off weekend. It's just a grind, right? But who can stay the course? Who can be consistent? Who doesn't have the injuries? That's what you're going to see. But everybody says, hey, it's a test. You're about to find out. It's the test. They're going to get here and, hey, ready to start opening weekend.
For the Alabama Crimson Tide, a great start to the season at 15-2, really thanks to the 1-2 punch at the top of the order with Gage Miller and TJ McCants.
Yeah, both these guys new to Alabama uniforms, the transfer, Miller from JUCO, TJ McCants. He's been in the SEC at Ole Miss, but right now, boy, the new uniform is looking good. 417, look at that. 14 home runs. So they're doing it all, right? Hit by pitches. They're just getting on base. But the biggest thing is they're providing on-base guys for the middle part of that lineup, and that's why Alabama's lineup's been good.
You can say the same thing about the Tennessee Volunteers, one of the most potent offenses in the nation.
Yeah, I mean, I said Bama's has been good, Tennessee's has been better, and they've been really good. You know, say, this is D1 ranks. This is not even conference ranks, but still, it's that good. I mean, heck, they've been the winningest program since 2021 and also the most home runs. So Coach Vitello has built an absolute dynamite team and that where they're starting to recruit nationwide now.
Tonight's the first time the Vols have played on the road this season, so they'll be at the plate in the top of the first with Christian Moore, Blake Burke, and Billy Amick. A lot of power at the top of the order, but really 1-9. This is a talented Tennessee batting order.
Well, I mean, it's power throughout the lineup. I mean, all the way down. I mean, there's like, I think, 7 guys with 6 home runs, and so it's guys that can beat you from the top to the bottom, and I think you're going to see that with both teams. But Tennessee right now, like you said, the lineup is as good as it gets, and they're as confident as it gets as well.
Watch out later on for Dean Curley, the SEC Freshman of the Week, after his 3-homer game last week against Kansas State. Tonight, the Crimson Tide give the baseball to Ben Hess, who's now in his junior season here in Tuscaloosa. And Lance, it's a good thing that Alabama has somebody they can turn to with SEC experience.
Yeah, and it's one of those guys that, like, it's not just experience, it's SEC caliber, right? It's top of the lineup stuff. You know, I don't know if it's a first round type guy. He could, though. I mean, when you're talking an explosive fastball like that at up to 97, 98, and he's a guy that can pitch. It's 4 pitches in the zone, but it's, again, it's a guy that's pitched before on the weekends, and what better to turn to go up against the number 5 team in the country for Alabama is Ben Hess. That's who they want on the mound.
Hess against Christian Moore to start this game. SEC baseball is underway. With the first pitch popped up to center field. It'll be LeBron, the shortstop for the Crimson Tide. 1 pitch, 1 out for Tennessee in the top of the first.
I mean, this is what you're going to see. We got some tough sky, right? You got the clouds have rolled in. Even behind them, though, it looks pretty. So I saw TJ McCants. He's coming in. His hands are out there like I don't know where it's at. So you got to see. I mean, like, you're seeing different ones that is going up there. And LeBron, he catches that ball in, what, shallow right field. So you got to give a credit to the freshman staying with that ball.
Here's Blake Burke, the first baseman. First pitch in there from Hess for a strike. Blake Burke for Tennessee homered on Sunday against Illinois. He was ejected after he said something to the Illinois catcher after rounding the bases. Teams had already had a warning for unsportsmanlike conduct, so as a result, he was ejected and missed the Tuesday game against Eastern Kentucky, but he'll get a base hit in his return here, a single to right field for Tennessee. Pop out and a single given up by Hess. Oh, man aboard for Tennessee with another dangerous hitter to the plate with serious power in Billy Amick, the third baseman. Just off the plate from Hess, home plate umpire Christopher Griffith ruling on balls and strikes. Billy Amick, second in the SEC, tied for second with 9 homers, leads Tennessee with 21 runs batted in.
You know, I talked about the lineup production all the way through, and it's it's five or six guys, five guys with six, one guy's got five, but it's also, like you said, leads in RBIs. It's RBI production all the way through, too. So it's guys are getting on, and everybody's getting them in. And that's how you have a lineup that can sustain success throughout the year and avoid those big slumps.
And then transferring from Clemson to Tennessee. Faced the Vols in a regional a year ago, but already off to a great start with Tennessee. Tied for second in the league in home runs, fifth in 57 total bases.
You know, you're seeing that a lot, Roger. Guys that transfer, the team played them the year before. So, like, the coaches get a really good look. They're like, hey, that guy would look really good. He's already an orange at Clemson, but he'd look really good in our orange. And so, you know, I've seen that a couple times with guys. I know I remember Alabama had Ed Johnson. They saw him play the year before and, like, hey, just, you know, come on over.
Walk to Amick, but two aboard for Tennessee. Burke with a single, and now Amick at first. Tony Vitello did not like game planning against Billy Amick in that Clemson regional a year ago, but seventh season as Tennessee's head coach, already two trips to Omaha. It's been a remarkable turnaround for this Tennessee program.
Again, like I mentioned, since 2021, they have the most wins in college baseball, and it's not even close. They're 15 wins ahead of Arkansas, and then home run production. It just proved that his style of baseball, kids love it. And they're like, yeah, I'd love to go up there and just, you know, have the freedom to swing like I want to play like I want to. And that's what Coach Vitello does. He gives his guys just the freedom to be who they are. And I think that's why the success has been there.
Since 2021, those 168 total wins had that such a dominant 2022 season, maybe one of the best regular seasons we've seen in college baseball. Escobar's Tears takes a strike down in the count of no balls, two strikes. But last year had to fight and claw their way on the road to get to Omaha.
And that's just, like, that's where you go. Like, hey, they've shown during the regular season that they are top-notch. But that just shows you how hard it is to get to Omaha when you are that good in the regular season.
Hess strikes out Tears.
That's a big at-bat right there for Hess. Gives up the hit, then goes to a walk, which, hey, smart, maybe it's a smart walk pitching around Amick, but you got a guy right here that's just hot. And he goes breaking ball, back-to-back with two strikes and freezes him.
Morris Tears has been riding a 16-game hitting streak for Tennessee. Two on for Dylan Dreiling, who's also been hot at the plate. He's homered in three of his last four games. Two on with two gone in this top of the first. Inside fastball misses at 96 miles per hour for Ben Hess. Works inside, misses inside again with a fastball, 2-0.
You know, when you have that depth in the lineup and that pitcher works real hard, he gets that two outs. Like, a lot of times, guys, like, you'll see pitchers, like, take that deep breath. You can't take the deep breath now. I mean, this is just as important of a bat and just as hot of a hitter.
Drawing knocks it foul, 2-1. Has started game one of Alabama's doubleheader last Saturday against Lipscomb, gave up three runs and four hits, also mixed in two walks with four strikeouts. Went four innings in that start.
Yeah, he's a victim of some tough wind. And that game, the wind was blowing straight out. And it was that game, 20-13, massive run scoring.
3 balls and a strike to Dreiling.
You're already seeing right now, like, the scouting report on Dreiling is like we got to bust the fastball up and in. That's where Hess is going, two of the three fastballs. So if I'm Dreiling, I'm open up a little bit thinking this 3-1 pitch, I won't miss it in.
Fouls it off now, full count. Dreiling, a 455 hitter with the runners in scoring position this season. Blake Burke got it going with a single. Went to second on the walk to Amick. Two on with two gone in the top of the first. Payoff pitch. Just high, ball four. A fastball at 97 misses upstairs for Hess, and now the bases are loaded.
Boy, this is close, man. This is fastball in. But see, like, Gassetti's just such a good receiver. He makes that look better. And obviously, when Dreiling stands up, it looks like the belt, but it is a little bit off, you know, because when, especially at the height. So, a good catcher can, boy, can frustrate a crowd.
Bases loaded, two gone. Robin Villeneuve at the plate. First pitch strike to Villeneuve, who hit a grand slam on Sunday against Illinois for the Tennessee Vols. It helped secure a sweep and an 8-3 win in Knoxville. Hess gets in front, 0-2.
You got an aggressive swinging team like Tennessee. So, I mean, they're seeing ball out of the hand. He's showing right now that the breaking pitch is really good and it's sharp. So they're not wrecking that because they're swinging right through it. And so when you have a fastball hitting team, you've got to be able to throw that pitch for strikes. If you can, then you go to fastball later in the game.
Staying away with the fastball, 1-2.
Because when they're... When guys hunt the fastball as a pitcher, you're thinking, I got to be perfect with the fastball. And so you see him trying to be perfect, maybe hook that a little bit too much. But he's throwing the slider and the curveball with conviction. And sometimes you got to go, you know, the team's going to make you adjust early. Go with that one early if you have it, and then go back to the fastball late.
The 1-2. On the way, two balls and two strikes to Villeneuve, native of Quebec. Home run, the grand slam he picked up was his third homer of the year for Tennessee on Sunday against Illinois. Two, two. Just off the plate, a fastball at 96 miles an hour makes it a full count.
Boy, he's painting all over that glove side of the plate, and this is off. I'm telling you, Gassetti makes it look better, but man, those used to be strikes. Those used to be strikes.
Sky foul, do it again at three balls, two strikes.
And that's what makes, if you get an umpire that will start to expand the zone a little bit, and you got guys that can throw 96 where they want to, like Ben Hess can, that can be a long night. But if you get a guy that makes it the ball get across the plate, you know, the hitters feel good about that. If you can lay off of it, then he feels like you got to come into me.
Bases loaded, two gone. 3-2. Breaking ball gets away. Tennessee will take a 1-0 lead. We'll hold on there. 1-0 start for the Volunteers. The bases loaded walk to Robin Villeneuve.
I mean, that just shows you the ultimate respect, right? Going 3-2 breaking ball. But that also shows as a pitcher, what does he feel most comfortable with? He's going to the pitch that he knows, I got to make it, and he chokes it a little bit. Quick early mound visit right here.
Jason Jackson, the associate head coach of the Crimson Tide and the pitching coach who has worked with Ben Hess all throughout his time in Tuscaloosa, trying to help out Hess get through this top of the first, took over as the interim head coach for the Crimson Tide last year on May 4th, guided Alabama to a regional win as well as an appearance in a super regional.
And just, you hear all the stories about how much of a glue guy he was just to keep the program not only where it was, because they had some success a little bit, but then he absolutely elevated it. The guys, he brought them back together. I mean, and the run that they went on in the year was unbelievable, and I think that's why you're seeing him still in the Alabama dugout.
Ben Hess, one strikeout, but three walks in this inning, including back-to-back walks. Facing another grand slam threat in Dean Curley. Bases full of Volunteers with two outs. Hess attacks with a fastball to start this at-bat against Dean Curley, the reigning SEC Freshman of the Week, in large part thanks to a three-homer game against Kansas State that included a grand slam.
You know, coaches preach. Games come down to, you know, four or five pitches, right? It seems like this could be that at-bat. You know, if Hess is able to get out of it and it only keeps it at one, you know, it's a win. You give up a big ball in the gap right here, and you give Tennessee a 3-4-run lead already, and you're having to climb uphill against a guy with a 1-3-1 ERA at Causey.
1-2 to Curley. Fastball for a called third strike at 95 miles per hour. The strikeout helps Hess escape the jam, only allowing one run to this potent Tennessee offense.
Yeah, Ben Hess, I mean, that's stepping up right there. I'm telling you, that was one of those at-bats that you look at the end of the game. You can see right there, Curley looking breaking ball because he absolutely freezes on this fastball. And look at him, 95, dots it up right there, Ben Hess.
Getting the Friday night start for Tennessee to start SEC play is junior A.J. Causey, the transfer from Jacksonville State here in the state of Alabama. He's from Harvest, Alabama, so pitching just 2.5 hours from home as he gets the ball for the Volunteers. Great results to start the season.
Absolutely. If you like that, 30 strikeouts, 3 walks, and a 1-3 ERA, yeah, I think you'll take that. But how about that? First start in the SEC for Tennessee, gets to do that in his home state. But, I mean, it's a weird slot, right? You see, it's lower than three quarters, but it's not truly sidearm, but he'll move it up and down. But the fastball up to 94 from that slot, you know it's going to have a lot of run. Slider acts like a frisbee, so it's more side to side necessarily, not up down. And then watch out for the changeup, especially to the lefties, but he will throw it to righties as well.
Causey getting the ball for Tennessee against this Alabama lineup that, again, starts strong at the top with what we've seen this year from Gage Miller and then T.J. McCants, who's hit safely in 17 games in a row.
Yeah, that's the McCants that Alabama saw and wanted, and especially when I think they really felt like Caden Rose was going to be coming back, and then all of a sudden he leaves, and they're like, that's the guy we got to go get, and hoping he would go back to what he looked like his freshman year at Ole Miss, and he really has.
Miller hits that one foul to start this at-bat. Gage Miller, a tremendous start to the season for the Alabama Crimson Tide. Leads Alabama with 30 runs scored. That is third in D1, second best in the SEC. And then the home run threat from the leadoff hitter. Rob Bond loves having that at the top of the order.
He's also, this is a guy that's all over the plate. And so he's challenging pitchers because he knows his hands are quick. So he's got 9 hit by pitches already, too. So wouldn't doubt it if a couple balls off a Causey run in, but not that one right there. That's the frisbee. It's not hard. So when you got the ball coming out 90 to 92 miles an hour from the side, and then this comes out, and it just really, it's almost like slow motion. And then, yep, left turn.
Strikeout begins this start for Causey against the Crimson Tide. Here's T.J. McCants. Center fielder for Alabama, transferring over from Ole Miss. 3 years there for the Rebels, including winning a national championship 2 years ago. Knocks it foul to even the count of 1-1. Again, a 17-game hitting streak for McCants. He's also driven in at least one run, 10 of 17 games Alabama's played this year.
Yeah, he's been as productive as anybody in that Alabama lineup. And again, a lot of it, Gage Miller right in front of him. So right now, Causey's shown him all three. You've seen the running fastball that basically ran all the way across the plate. Then the next pitch is a changeup, looks just like the fastball and just falls off the table. And then he throws him the little frisbee, tried to go backdoor. So he's just showing you a little bit of everything.
Stroke tie and deep to center field. Ensley all the way back, but it's gone. T.J. McCants ties this game at 1 with a solo homer. Home run number 7 for T.J. McCants.
Well, Raj, I said he showed him everything he's got from Causey, but T.J. McCants said, I'll show you what I got. Well, that's a fastball way over the batter's eye. Look at that middle. It just runs right back over the middle. T.J. McCants not trying to do too much, right? Hit it where it's pissed. It just absolutely right down the middle, and he blasts it over the batter's eye, way over the batter's eye.
Causey will focus on Ian Petrutz, the left fielder for the Crimson Tide. 451 feet off the bat of T.J. McCants. Trunts, the transfer from Maryland. Getting his first taste of SEC baseball, same can be said Several players in this lineup for the Crimson Tide. Kazi challenged him inside. Now a 2-ball, 2-strike count. Knock found by Petrutz.
You know, that's a tough AB from that slot because you don't know if the ball is coming in, like the slider, especially the lefty, if it's going to run away, if it's going to go down and away like the changeup. So when your guy can throw three quality pitches for strikes, especially from that angle, can be really tough on a hitter. And you're seeing right there, right? So he slows up the swing. And he's thinking, fastball, oh, wait up. That's the one coming right out of my hands. And you can see him just change his swing as he goes to it.
Kazi's worked with former Major League pitcher Steve Cishek, who played collegially at Carson Newman University in D2 school, about 30 minutes away from Knoxville. Really worked on a slider grip with him. Cishek also had a very similar arm angle. Challenged him inside, but Trutz sticks around.
Well, that's kind of like the transformation, I guess, would be. I don't know if it's the right word I'm looking for, but like usually when you know, late 90s, early 2000s, when guys threw sidearm, they didn't throw hard. So, I mean, to be able to throw the ball 90-something miles an hour.
Drilled to right field. Alabama's in front. Ian Petrutz with a solo homer. Back-to-back jacks for the Tide with McCants and Petrutz. Welcome to SEC Baseball, Ian Petrutz.
You know, a lot of times that's the problem when you start showing guys every pitch. And he went back to the changeup. Petrutz was right on it. And another ball absolutely crushed out of the stadium. No doubt. That's two no-doubters right off the bat. That's one way to get your team fired up. Go back-to-back home runs in the first inning. You can see the Tide loving it.
106 off the bat for Petrutz. So back-to-back solo homers. Here's Evan Slight. Cleanup batter for the Crimson Tide, who's already hit four homers this year. The captain of this team, transferring over from Rutgers. Everyday right fielder for the Crimson Tide. Plenty of pop in his bat as well, with four homers, 19 runs batted in. What's Kazi got to go back to?
I'm waiting to see that because the fastball's got so much movement. Throwing that fastball at the left-hander's hip, kind of like that one. But see how it, you know, it's almost seemed like that's what he tried to do to McCants, but you didn't start it far enough at the hip. Where you almost like Greg Maddux, where you see the ball and, you know, he's trying to go in what they call a comebacker. That's just not starting enough at the hitter's hip. Because if you do, boy, you have that hitter getting out of the way and that ball's gonna be a strike.
Kazi strikes out Slight, two gone.
But that's how when you back that up with that. You're thinking, hey, it looks the same, and that's what's making that changeup really, really good is he doesn't show it, doesn't tip it like a lot of guys will do.
William Hameter next up for the Crimson Tide, the fifth-year senior from here in Tuscaloosa. He's been in and out of the starting lineup this year for Alabama. Tonight will just be his second start for the Crimson Tide. Has played in five games, but has been a starter at times in his Alabama career, and a really veteran bat that Rob Vaughn can trust against a guy like Kazi.
Yeah, I think that's what why he's in the lineup, because he does have that veteran approach, you know, a guy that's just doesn't seem overmatched no matter what type of pitcher is out there. And so you have guys that will hit the fastball better than some and guys that can hit all speed a little bit better. Hameter's just one of those guys that really doesn't matter who's on the mound, he's going to give you a quality at bat.
This is the 60th SEC game that Hameter's played in. So plenty of experience going back all the way to 2020 when he's a freshman. 10 homers, 80 runs batted in throughout his Crimson Tide career, a career 262 hitter. The 1-2. Got him swinging. So A.J. Kazi with three strikeouts in the inning, but a pair of home runs allowed has given Alabama a 2-1 lead.
You like to take the three strikeouts in, but when there's three strikeouts in between these, a McCants blast and a Petrutz blast, don't make you feel good walking off the mound. 2-1, Alabama.
Fans having a good time out on the right field terrace, which is open to all fans, no matter if you're an Alabama student or not. Final weekend of spring break. A lot of Tennessee fans made the trip down to Tuscaloosa as well for the rivalry renewed. We always talk about the third Saturday in October for Alabama versus Tennessee football. How about the third Friday in March?
It's tough. That's a tough part about, you know, opening conference at home when it is spring break, because you know the students aren't there. Because that's even for the visiting team, right? You go on the road, you expect to get harassed and all those kind of things. And, you know, you'd love to hear stories of the right fielder or wherever the student section is. And here at Alabama, it would be the right fielder coming in being like, man, they won't leave me alone.
Evan Slidespin, the everyday right fielder for the Crimson Tide. They love him.
Yeah,
Kamara's tears, not so much for Tennessee.
Everything's positive to Evan.
Cannon Peebles, Tennessee catcher. Sees that one upstairs from Ben Hess.
It's been really good about the Tennessee lineup so far. As Hess has gotten ahead, right? He's been to that 0-2, 1-2 count pretty quickly, but they've done a great job of fighting and getting to the 2-2, 3-2, and making Hess throw a lot of pitches.
Breaking ball just outside, full count. Was that the first curve?
I think
one of the first few ones we've seen.
He's throwing a little slurvish, but that was the first true overhand, a little bit slower in that 72 range.
Back to the fastball, it's up the middle. And the play made as the overshift worked for the Crimson Tide.
You know, so right now, it being a 2-1 ball game, you're like, cool, you go, hey, Hess, whatever. But still, at 34 pitches already, you know, the name of the game is to get that starter out, especially when on a Friday night. You can get into the bullpen as quick as you can. It's going to bode well for the rest of the weekend.
2-1, Alabama leading Tennessee in the top of the second. That was chopped foul off the bat of Hunter Ensley. One out and nobody on base. It was Ensley on Sunday. Pinch hit home run against Illinois that started Tennessee's comeback. Balls trailed 3-0 in the bottom of the fifth. He went deep with his second homer of the year. Hess gets in front 0-2. Escaping that jam last inning. Strikeout looking against Curley. Already a ground out against Peebles. Now the 0-2 to Ensley. Got him looking. Curve again.
Well, that's the second, like, frozen breaking ball. And to me, like, he's thrown the big overhand. He's thrown the tight slider. No, that's the big overhand. That's 77. That's beautiful right there. Come out of the hand. You see the spin. Gassetti knows. He drops to that one knee. That's a great feeling as a pitcher when the hitter just stands there and looks down and just walks off without even thinking.
Two gone. No one on base for the top of the order with Christian Moore. Foul tip for strike one. Moore had a pop out to shortstop on the very first pitch of the game an inning ago. Down the right field line, but fell. Hess in front, 0-2.
But we got the book on Christian Moore. C-ball, swing. This is seen three pitches, swinging at all of them. Fastball, sliders.
Breaking ball just missed inside, went back to the curb. Upstairs fastball, 2-2.
I like that. You know, most people would think, oh, he's going to go back to that same pitch because he had him fooled a little bit. I like him trying to go fastball right there.
Full count. Moore trying to extend the top of the second. Payoff pitch. throws him again. Another strikeout for Ben Hess. Already 4-2 innings against Tennessee.
Well, Ben Hess has finally found the groove right there after that first inning. A little tough with those walks, but he pitched around him. But, man, he's got the off-speed working in that overhand curveball. Four punch outs early.
Catcher Matt Cassetti leads off the bottom of the second for Alabama. And to give you an idea of how much has changed for the Crimson Tide since last June, he's the only player from the starting lineup that remains on this team and on this roster really for the Crimson Tide, at least among regular starters for Alabama. So much lost from a year ago, but so much has been rebuilt by Rob Vaughn and his staff.
And it's tough because, you know, there was, you're coming to a new school. Like, it's easier when you're there and you've been, you know, looking at the rosters for your roster. But then all of a sudden you take over a roster and you see all that exodus and you're like, all right, we got to figure it out. So, I mean, his staff did a great job. Anthony Papio, Mike Morrison, Mikey White and the boys, they did a good job of just really filling up the transfer portal.
Cossie just runs that inside 2-2, but they're thrilled that Cassetti sticks around for the Crimson Tide because, of course, they love his bat, love his production, but they love how he works with this pitching staff and Jason Jackson, the pitching coach. He'll strike out to begin this bottom of the second for the Crimson Tide. Causey with four strikeouts. Rob Vaughn, welcome to the SEC. He has built up a solid roster, 13th best class ranking in high school baseball, and then transfer portal additions, 8th best. Rob Vaughn, who now getting to coach against the best of the best in the Southeastern Conference. Great success for him at the University of Maryland before he was hired by the Crimson Tide. Will Hodo fouling off the first pitch from Causey.
You know, we saw those, look at that, best start at an Alabama career, 11-0. But we saw the rankings, right? The high school, that's really the old staff because those are the relationship you're working. But the transfers, him rolling in here, and it wasn't like it was the best of scenarios. He gets the job, and he gets right on that recruiting trail, and they did. It's not just, hey, everybody can spot the best players. It's to find the guys that transfer in that are not necessarily big names and have all started to play.
Well, Hodo now in his third season in Tuscaloosa. Saw some time in the starting lineup in the first half of SEC play a year ago. Takes over as the everyday first baseman for the Crimson Tide. Went with a number change as well, going from number 1 to number 18. Previous number of Alabama's previous first baseman, longtime first baseman Drew Williamson.
I love how Causey's not afraid to use the changeup. I mean, it's because it looks so much like the fastball. Can't overstate that when it comes out of the hand, and it's almost like he absolutely is pulling the string.
Spins that one outside, even the count to Hoda. Two-two. Hodo fouls that one away. A ball put in play, a base hit for Will Hodo. One out single here in the second.
This is a good piece of hitting right there, Roger. I mean, it's a defensive swing, but when you play the shift and defensive swing, sometimes don't necessarily, the ball doesn't go where you think it's going to go. So Hodo keeps his hands in. I mean, this is not an easy at bat with A.J. Causey up at the plate.
Crimson Tide shortstop Justin LeBron. Off to a great start in his first year in Tuscaloosa. You talk about some of the recruiting done. Talk to the old staff, and then one of Rob Vaughn's first priorities was to go down to Miami and make sure that Justin LeBron is going to be a member of the Crimson Tide for this year, and it was a great family dynamic you walked into.
Yeah, that's one of those where you get the job, you're like, all right, where do I need to go? And that's one of the first stops, and like just making sure you're on the boat with us, right?
Causey in front, 1-2. Seeing Justin LeBron for Alabama and Dean Curley for Tennessee. Both of these players have been named the SEC Freshman of the Week already through the first month of the year. Odo safe at first.
Yeah, I think they're the staff. When you look at Justin LeBron, I think they're, I mean, I know they're happy of what they're seeing because they really expected just more of a glove first guy. And like if anything that we get with the bat's going to be good, but he's come in and really done a great job of producing offensively.
Strikes out looking, all the outs, still strikeouts for Causey, now up to 5.
Well, AJ Causey showing you why he came into tonight's game with a 30 strikeout to 3 walk, you know, strikeout to walk ratio. And now he's got 5 more adding to that. So he's a guy that will strike out a lot of guys. And I think you're seeing the zone maybe expand a little bit outside of that first inning. Hess seemed to be all around it. Well, the one that ended the inning for Hess looked to be a little bit away. That one looks to be a little bit away as well.
Two gone in this bottom of the second. Causey allowed back-to-back solo homers to T.J. McCants and Ian Petrutz. Now he's facing Crimson Tide senior Bryce Eblin. 397 batting average, ninth best in the SEC. It's second best on the Crimson Tide.
Not bad to have that coming out of the ninth hole.
Alabama fans just glad to see him healthy. Top-rated prep player coming out of Indiana when he signed years ago with Crimson Tide has battled injuries during his time in Tuscaloosa.
What'd everybody tell you in Little League when you were the nine-hole hitter?
Nine-hole hitter just gets a base hit to left here.
Like, hey, that's okay. You're the second leadoff, right? And you're like, no, I'm not. So we've got 2 hits this inning for Alabama, and you're looking at really the balls haven't been hit hard. They've just been in the right spot, just letting the ball do it. So as a sinker ball, that ball's running in the way to the lefty. I'm surprised to see you see them shift over that much. If not, then maybe you might see Billy Amick move over a little bit toward that 6-hole.
Batting average now 407 for Eblin. Top of the order back to the plate with Gage Miller. Strikeout his first time to the plate, getting the first look for the Crimson Tide against A.J. Causey.
I'm telling you, the first inning, it was a lot tighter zone. Now you're looking at some breaking. It's not just fastballs, it's breaking balls that are going out that way.
Nice swing by Miller to even the count.
Yeah, see, if I'm a hitter, I'd rather that be called the strike than the one that's going away even farther off the plate that I can't touch.
Miller, the home run pop, like we talked about, 8 homers on the year. He's also been driving in 24 runs for the Crimson Tide. That's an only 17 games coming into this one. Causing another opportunity for another strikeout. 2 on with 2 gone for Alabama. Spotted a little high.
That's the pitch. That's the one. If he throws that to the lefties, that's that comebacker, which you see Gage Miller absolutely gave up on that one just because it looks like it's so far away and it's got so much run coming back.
2 on with 2 gone. Ball 4. The base is loaded for Alabama. Great opportunity coming up for T.J. McCants. Last time up, he homered.
Yeah, he's got a chance now. Tennessee couldn't get that big hit with bases loaded in the first inning. T.J. McCants getting a shot. Boy, he hopes he gets a pitch just like that. What was that, 451, 109 off the bat, dead center.
So before McCants can come up to the plate, Tennessee will have a meeting on the mound. Causey trying to be careful with McCants. And here's Frank Anderson. Pitching coach in his 7th year in Knoxville. Should help out Causey through quite a jam. Bases loaded, now 2 gone.
Now how about the Frank Anderson effect? I mean, the staff ERA since he's gotten, or just go back to 19, 31st, okay, you know, or 19th, actually. Then he went 4th, 10th, 1st in the country, 2nd in the country, 4th in the country. That's not bad. That's getting it done. Because they also get it done at the plate, too. That's why they have the most wins since 2021.
Breaking ball to McCants starts this at bat from Causey, but 5th best ERA, 13th best in the nation strikeout to walk ratio, and of course seen that with 5 strikeouts compared to 1 walk. McCants knocks it high but fell. Now Causey in front, 0-2. Solo shot for McCants, his 7th home run of the year. Base is loaded for Alabama.
Alabama doing their job at the plate, too. 51 pitches and
check swing. Did he go? No, says third base umpire Kevin Elzey. 2-2.
Thought process here. We're trying to stay as a pitcher 15 pitches an inning. So when you're talking, you're well over that just through the second inning. So it'd be tough to get deep in the game.
Ooh. Pretty close. 2-2. Knocked foul. Over 50 pitches for Causey through the first 2 innings against Alabama. Trying to escape this jam in the second. And he will. Strikeout number 6 for Causey. Alabama loads the bases but will not score here in the bottom of the second. It remains a 2-1 lead for the tie against the Vols. Two to one Crimson Tide lead over Tennessee as we get set for the top of the third. All the scoring was in the first inning. The Vols with a bases loaded walk to Robin Villeneuve for the Crimson Tide. Back-to-back home runs by T.J. McCancy and Petrutz to give Ben Hess a 2-1 advantage. And he responded well with a 1-2-3 second. Now he's got to face Blake Burke. 6 homers this year for Burke. One of the top power threats for this Tennessee baseball team. Needs 4 homers to tie the Tennessee program record of 40, held currently by Luke Lipsius. Fastball on 95. And on the hands to Blake Burke. Chop foul to first.
Ben Hess trying to use the change up as well. Goes fastball up for, and you see a big old aggressive hack. I think it's a nice job going with the changeup. You see him out in front, but maybe want to put that a little bit lower, bounce that. Because once you get the guy swinging, you want that ball low enough to where he can't touch it.
1-2 again. Down the way, it'll still be a 1-ball, 2-strike count to Burke. 5 homers in the last 10 games for the everyday first baseman for the Volunteers, Blake Burke. Into the shift. Crimson Tide will make the play.
And Roger, this is going to look like, okay, it's a 4-3, right? That's not as easy to play. You see how Evelyn, he sees the ball coming off that dirt as he's so far into the grass, plays it off to the side a little bit, but just trust the hands, made the play. That's a lot harder play than he made it look. And so you have a guy like Eblen that could be playing shortstop, but when you have a guy that's so talented at shortstop like LeBron is, it allows you some flexibility to move him to third, move him to second if you need it.
Now another overshift going up against Billy Amick. Amick a walk his first time to the plate. Well, he falls, or Hess falls behind, two balls and no strikes. Zamek with 9 home runs this season for Tennessee.
I wonder what the percentage is that guys, that infield play straight up. Like, I bet it's way more, way higher percentage that guys are going to shift than play straight up. You want to see respect. That's a 2-0 breaking ball.
To Amick. Take an inside strike on a fastball. Went back to the fastball, 3-2.
There's a lot of scouts here this game, and that's what they want to see. They want to see, you know, fastball against fastball hitter and see, and that's 3-1. That's, you know, it's coming and you can't hit it.
That one to the backstop for the second walk of the game for Amick.
It looked like right there where Hess just felt like, I need to do more, right? You just blew it by him at 93 miles an hour. That one was 94, and you could tell he maybe tried to hump up a little bit. You don't have to. You put the ball where you want to, you get him out. Shows you how disciplined, though, Amick is.
Tavares Tier is the cleanup batter. He struck out looking his first time to plate against Hess. Tier's really been patient for his opportunity to play for the Volunteers, a redshirt sophomore from Lewisburg, Tennessee. Hits that high into center field. LeBron, the shortstop, is there. 2 gone. Dylan Dreiling drew one of the 3 walks against Hess in the first inning that helped result in Tennessee's first run of the game. Check it first, back in safely, Billy Amick. 2 stolen bags for him this year, a Tennessee team that's 13 for 17 on the base paths.
When you hit 400 and something home runs since 2021, you don't have to run.
Don't run it out.
Yeah, please don't give our offense an out away. Let them swing for the fence. That would be my coaching philosophy.
Coach Cormier. Destroyed high and deep to right field. Dreiling has powered Tennessee in front, 3-2. Home runs in 4 of the last 5 games for Dylan Dreiling.
Well, just when you think you've kind of gotten through the part of it. I mean, this is a guy with unbelievable pop, 92. You can't work there, Ben Hess. That ball is absolutely crushed. Getting Tennessee back in front.
7th home run for Dreiling. Now, 1 run advantage for the Vols as Robin Villeneuve is at the plate. He drew the bases loaded walk that gave Tennessee the initial lead, and the daddy cap remains the fur coat for the Volunteers. Of course, all those props have got to stay in the dugout these days in college baseball. It's good to see that daddy calf tradition continue for Tennessee from Evan Russell years ago. Although he already took it off.
Don't want to get it too sweaty.
The 1-2. Curveball ran inside. Just missing outside after he'd missed just inside the pitch before. Curveball then fastball for Hess. Ball four. Fifth walk for Hess tonight.
And again, Rod, just another one of those where you're two strikes in the first three pitches, and then you kind of start to nibble a little bit. Thought he had a break. Again, relying on that breaking ball with 3-2. He's done I think he's done that twice now and had the walks where just not trusting the fastball.
On the trip to the mound for Jason Jackson, Hess at 67 pitches. We're in the top of the third. We've seen a lot of pitches over 50 so far for A.J. Causey as these guys are really having to work early on in these starts against, again, two great offenses in Tennessee and Alabama.
And that's the mark of the good offense, right? It's going to get to those guys. I think if we see any of these pitchers in the fifth inning, it'll be a shock. I mean, it's going to be a bullpen game from then on out.
One so far for Ben Hess. As he starts against the Tennessee Volunteers. Hess was in the weekend rotation a year ago for the Crimson Tide before he was shut down midway through SEC play, would not return for Alabama. Sideline after his start against Arkansas, but he had been 4-0 across seven starts prior to that. As Hess again made seven starts, McNary Holman led the way with 17-15. Luke Holman now starring for the LSU Tigers.
Boy, what kind of start has he had? Boy, that's one of those guys that, you know, talk about impact transfers, and you lose, you know, quite what might be the best pitcher on the planet in Paul Skeens, and you get to replace a guy on Friday night like Luke Holman, who, again, stuff's not quite there, but I've seen interviews from Jay Johnson, his coach, like, hey, he doesn't quite have the stuff as Paul Skeens, but just the pitchability is off the chart. And so, I mean, to be able to just be mentioned in something like that, and again, I don't think he's given up a run. He's got 40-something punch-outs already this year.
Dean Curley, the shortstop, gets in front, two balls, no strikes. Curley struck out looking his first time up. Seventieth pitch from Hess. Great honors for Curley, the SEC Freshman of the Week. Not just those three homers that he picked up against Kansas State, he also drove in 9 of his 11 runs in that ball game in Knoxville.
Yeah, not so bad. You can win Freshman of the Week off of one game. I mean, three of the homers, 9 of the 11 RBIs off of just that one game.
It was a freshman record, 9 runs batted in. It was just off the overall program record of 10 held by Joe Randa back in 1991, before Joe Randa went on to a solid major league career.
Those back-to-back fastballs right there might have been Ben Hess's best two fastballs of the night, that 94 on the black at the knees.
Lifted high to center, McCants. Puts it away, and that'll close out the inning, but not before Tennessee takes control of this game thanks to a 2-run homer by Dylan Dreiling.
Yeah, how about that? Dylan Dreiling breaks track, man. We have no data, but guess what? It was hit hard, and it went real far. 2-run home run, 3-2 Volunteers.
Alabama fans were still celebrating a home run by T.J. McCants when Ian Petrutz was at the plate. He also homered off A.J. Causey. That's what gave the Crimson Tide a 2-1 lead in the bottom of the first. Maryland transfer Ian Petrutz with his second home run as a member of the Crimson Tide. He's coming off a great weekend against Lipscomb here at this ballpark, where he was 5-for-10 playing that doubleheader last Saturday, the single game on Sunday. Drove in three runs. Collinsy back to work. And he'll have to go against the heart of the Alabama order, Petrutz, Slight, Hammeter. Not only 3-4-5 in the order, but also three lefty batters. To center field. Ensley will make the running catch.
Well, Petrutz is seeing it good right there. That's a lonely feeling for an outfielder when, because you can see, yeah, he comes in, first step in instead of back, and then you see him turn on the jets. Ensley, great job of closing in on it, and Cossey's like, uh-oh, because you could see it. You could have that feeling of that ball's about to be burning. And anytime as an outfielder, you got to also turn around, turn that back, and run as hard as you can. It's like, oh, I screwed up. Everybody's watching.
Evan Slide, first pitch in there for a strike. Wearing the jersey number 3. Serving as the team captain for this team. He embodies the 3 core values of this Crimson Tide baseball program: ownership, toughness, and grit. A tradition that Rob Bond brought over from Maryland. So it's an honor to wear that jersey number 3 from here on out for Alabama baseball. And Evan Slight, first man to do so for the Crimson Tide.
You know, I mentioned how the transfer, right, Billy Amick, they play him, then they bring him over. Well, Coach Vaughn coached against Evan Slight, and he's like, hey, man, I like that number 3 you're wearing. Yeah, you're my kind of guy. I really like you, but I'm not going to be in Maryland. Can you come over to Tuscaloosa?
Slight was able to demonstrate to his teammates that he kind of had those values all throughout a fall where he maybe wasn't hitting as well as he wanted to.
Well, you're talking about a guy that's been around college baseball, the experiences there. You know, if you're a good hitter, you're a good hitter. You know you're going to hit. And so that's kind of the thought that Evan Slight had, is even though he was struggling a little bit at the plate in the fall, he was still able to be just the unbelievable leader that really, you know, made the staff give him that number 3.
Back-to-back flyouts to center for Alabama against Causey. Yeah, the team was sent a survey at the end of fall ball, and 42 of the 44 ballots had Slight either 1 or 2 to be given the number 3.
Who are those other 2 guys?
Think of some candidates, but again, it was a landslide for Mr. Slight. Anthony Papio, third base coach for the Crimson Tide. The tradition started while Rob Vaughn was an assistant coach at Maryland. And Papio was first player to wear number 3 at Maryland. Now he gets to serve as the third base coach here. He wore the jersey number 3 for the Terrapins in this ballpark back in 2016.
I remember that. Hit a home run too, didn't he?
Here's a high, deep drive to center. Ensley's been busy in this inning, and he'll make 3 catches. Hammeter gave that a great ride, but that'll close out the frame. It's Tennessee holding on to a 1-run lead in Tuscaloosa. Taking a look at some of the best transfers in SEC baseball. We've already talked about Luke Coleman going from Alabama to LSU. Cannon Peebles from NC State to Tennessee. Billy Amick, a great addition as well. And then the Crimson Tide also lost Colby Shelton, who, of course, had a lot of home runs last year for the Crimson Tide, setting a freshman record for Alabama. He moves from Alabama to Florida. Right now it's Cannon Peebles of Tennessee who will lead off this top of the 4th inning. Hit .352, the everyday DH for the Wolfpack a year ago as only a freshman. Gets a starting nod as Tennessee's catcher in this ball game. Could see him DH some when Cal Stark catches. Ben Hess back to work, and he's now thrown more pitches in this start than any of his previous outings. Last week, 74 had been a season high against Lipscomb. Gets in front of Peebles at a ball and 2 strikes. Breaking ball called 3rd strike. That's with his 5th strikeout.
Boy, really good sequence right there, Roger. Fastballs, keeping him in, and then backdoor breaking ball, and it's still sharp, man. If Ben Hess gets the strike on the curveball up like that, oh, because then that makes his fastball up play even better.
One gone, Hunter Ensley. Upstairs, fastball for ball one. Tennessee only with two hits in this ball game, a single by Burke in the first, then the two-run homer by Dreiling last inning. Everything else basically walks, strikeouts for Hess in this game. Five walks, five strikeouts.
Yeah, that's just, a lot of that is just respect for the Tennessee lineup, because he's not a guy that's going to be nibbling much, right? With that kind of stuff, you don't have to nibble, and that's what he's done, because he knows, like, this lineup can beat you any hitter, and they can leave the yard at any point of the time. So I think that's what you're seeing, because that's not the type of pitcher he is.
Got him swinging, went back to the breaking ball. Six strikeouts, Ben Hess.
Well, Roger, one thing that he does so well is he adds and subtracts on each pitch, right? So most people are like, okay, fastball is this. You want to take, you know, take mile an hour off, you throw the changeup. No, like he can throw curveballs at 74 to 79. He's throwing, you know what I mean? Like, and so that's what you see is because guys just don't know exactly. Hey, they know the pitch, but they don't know if it's the 74 curveball or if it's the 79 one or if it's the 86 slider. That's true pitching when you can add and subtract on each of those, move it in and out.
Top of the order back to the plate with Christian Moore, 0 for 2 in this game against Hess. Inside, it hit him. Fastball at 93 miles per hour hits Moore.
That ball just got away. He's trying to go away. I mean, that's not intentional because you're looking at, you know, if you see the catcher in there, maybe, but like.
Jason Jackson out to speak with Ben Hess, and this might be it for Hess tonight. There's been some bullpen activity for the Crimson Tide. Call the bullpen will be made as Hess works 83 pitches, works into this fourth inning, gets the first two outs. But the Crimson Tide will go to the bullpen in the top of the fourth inning. Aiden Moza will take over for Alabama on the Hill. We'll tell you more about him when we return to Tuscaloosa. Right now, the Volunteers at 3-2 lead here in the fourth.
Well, Ben Hess, I mean, there's some positives, right? A lot of strikeouts. You had six punch outs, but, you know, you want to pitch deeper into the game this. But again, still battled his butt off and going out there and just continue to keep the guys in the zone for Alabama, keep the team in the game.
Now, Alabama gives the baseball to Aiden Moza, the junior from just across the border in Dallas, Georgia. Did see him earlier this week against Southern Miss. He's been used as a starting pitcher for Alabama, was slated to be the Sunday starter for Alabama to start the season. Things have shuffled a bit due to the injury of Riley Quick, the expected Saturday starter. Now Moza coming out of the bullpen where he has been effective during his time with Crimson Tide. 3-1 across 14 relief outings as a sophomore year ago. Now he's going to face Blake Burke. Rips that one foul. And it ricochets off the pole right back to Moza on the mound.
All right. I've been in this stadium a lot. I've never seen that happen.
One of Tennessee's most feared power hitters at the plate. Crushes that to right field. And Tennessee's in front 5-2. Blake Burke powers out his seventh homer of the year.
Well, Roger, with a two-out hit by pitch, you extend that inning. And I know Ben Hess, you know, he was wanting to finish that inning, you know, with a quality, just a perfect inning. And hits Christian Moore, and then Blake Burke makes him pay. I mean, that ball's just down and into a left-hander and just such a sweet swing. He knows he's got to drop the bat now, right? Can't pit many home runs when you already been tossed. So nice job. Swing it. Just, hey, guys know when you do it right.
Now just three away from the Tennessee program record of 40 home runs. Incredible work by Blake Burke, who again homered against Illinois on Sunday. It's part of Tennessee's comeback victory against Fighting Illini. Ejected after that home run. Had to miss earlier in the week against Eastern Kentucky, but now he's back with another Burke bomb. And Billy Amick at the plates. Another talented power hitter who already leads Tennessee with 9 homers this year. He drew 2 walks earlier in this game against Hess. Fastball 94 from Aiden Moza. Fouls away the slider.
Stuff wise, Moza's there, right? He's got what you want to see. But it's one of those where, like, hey, he's really good out of the bullpen. And I think that's why he's back in the bullpen so quickly, because they knew they had a gem with him, because he could go one inning, he could go 4. And I think some of those outings where he went 4.
Softly to shortstop, LeBron. Close play will close out the inning. We'll talk more about Moza coming up as he's able to get through this top of the 4th inning. But first, a Blake Burke home run for Tennessee has made it a 3-run Volunteer advantage.
Well, that's what happens. It's a little 2-out lightning right here. Get a hit by pitch, and then Blake Burke, such a sweet swing right there. 2 more runs for the Vols.
Top 15 matchup here in Tuscaloosa this weekend. You have 5th-ranked Tennessee, 14th-ranked Alabama among the many SEC teams that find themselves in the top 25. Arkansas leading the way at number 1. Cassetti drops that one foul. But again, just shows the balance, the strength of this league. There are ranked matchups up and down the scoreboard on this first weekend of conference action.
And what the crazy part about that is, you, what you don't see in there, which – over the past probably 10 years, you have always seen, is Ole Miss, Mississippi State.
Right.
So, I mean, that's 2 more teams that are notoriously in the top 15, not
well,
just
national
in the top
champions,
20, yeah.
2 of the last 3 years. I'm thinking 2 on Matt Cassetti.
And I think you'll see at least maybe 2 to 3 more teams that aren't in there. Somebody like a Mississippi State, like a Kentucky, like a Georgia is knocking on the door, even an Ole Miss. I mean, those teams, so I think what you'll see is as they go through that 10-week gauntlet, you'll beat up on each other, a couple of the bottoms will fall out, a couple other ones will jump in. So I think you really have a chance to have, you know, over the course of the year, 11, 12 teams from the SEC ranked.
SEC plays starting tonight, of course, the SEC tournament at the end of May in Hoover, Alabama, just 45 minutes away. Cassetti's played in that tournament with both Florida Gators and the Alabama Crimson Tide. Then, of course, the selection show on Memorial Day and regionals will start later that week. Last year, Alabama got to host a regional, one here in Tuscaloosa. While Tennessee had to go on the road to Clemson, played some really dramatic games, not just against the host Clemson Tigers, but against Charlotte as well. Kazi with a count full. Poked to first. Burke will make the play. Kazi back in this ballpark, again, had been part of the Jacksonville State program for the last 2 years. A two-way player there, not only a good pitcher, but had some at-bats as well for the Gamecocks. has transferred to Tennessee and has been off to a great start and gave up those two runs on the back-to-back homers in the first, but Lance has really settled in after that like you normally see from Friday night starters.
Yeah, he really has. I mean, the ball's been in the zone, and he's mixing the fastball and the changeup, which look identical out of the arm slot, out of the hand. It looks the same. Movement's the same, but, oh, by the way, there's 12 miles an hour difference, and that's why you see a lot of the Alabama hitters out on that front foot swinging over it. Yeah, how many times do you think he goes up to Tony Vitello and like, hey, coach, give me one at bat, give me a shot one time, right? I want to get in on this home run action.
Well, Hodo's got plenty of home run power, had a great series last weekend against Lipscomb.
I think he's one of those guys in the Alabama lineup. If you look at the end of the year, and Alabama's, you know, has postseason aspirations, and they're in the postseason, it's because he had a big year. I really do think so. I think it maybe not all hinges on him, but if he puts up numbers that you think he can, because, I mean, the body's there, the swing's there, it's just a matter of the experience and getting it consistent. If he can have that big year, it'll help out this Alabama offense.
Has been moving down a bit in the order, had been the everyday cleanup batter for the Crimson Tide, now batting seventh tonight, but this, again, still one of the best offensive clubs in NCAA baseball, in addition to being one of the best in the SEC. The Crimson Tide currently leading the league with a .343 team batting average. Contributions at the bottom of the order, a huge reason why, especially from a player like Justin LeBron. Causey gets in front 0-2. Fair ball to third. Amick across the green for the out, and that'll close out the inning. 1-2-3 go the Tide here in the bottom of the fourth. When we return, we'll have a conversation with Tennessee head coach Tony Vitello here on the SEC Network. See you with a 5-2 lead against Alabama as we start the top of the fifth. Roger Hoover and Lance Cormier upstairs, joined by the head coach of the Volunteers, Tony Vitello. And coach, thank you for joining us. AJ Causey allows a couple of runs in the first inning, but the last three innings about as sharp as he can be. What have you liked from your starter?
Yeah, the one thing he's done, regardless of how well they're hitting him, is continue to throw strikes, and he's had good presence out there for us. And this is a really physical lineup, and there's a lot of at-bats accumulated by some of these guys, different places, some of them in the SEC, some of them other places, but it's a good combination on offense. So the fact that Causey's been able to do what he's done so far has, you know, got us pleased.
Well, speaking of physical lineup, you have quite possibly maybe the most physical lineup. From your hitters, I thought their approach was really good on Ben Hess. What did you see?
Yeah, I mean, that guy's tough, and no one has really taken good swings off him. And at times, we didn't look very good at all in the box, and I think that's more of a tip your cap to how good his stuff is when he's on. But I think the guy scrapped pretty good to get the pitch count up, and then, you know, you did see the one good swing from Dill, but I think a little bit of that was because he was asked to do so much in a short amount of time to get the outs that he was getting.
Well, Coach, I got one more for you. I saw you, the excitement after that play, Billy Amick, ball deep down the line, and then it's just absolute rocket. That had to make you excited a little bit for that defensive play.
Yeah, I mean, you like when a guy helps his pitcher out because Cause is battling like their guys have, but Billy's worked really hard to be a good defender over there. I think everyone knows he's very capable at the plate, but he's worked really hard, and you like when a guy kind of makes a decision to be good at something, and it starts working out for him.
Coach, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Tony Vitello, the head coach of the Tennessee Volunteers. He has the middle of the order due up here. Tears, Dreiling, and Villeneuve. All starts with Kavaris Tears. Moza swinging a miss, strike three, but out completed. Tears 0 for 3 to start the night here in Tuscaloosa.
You know, and so we talked about Moza and what he could bring. Like, this is the type of game where you bring in a guy like him and he can finish it, you know, because he's built up as a starter, but he can bridge that gap to the back part of the bullpen, and he's got the stuff to be able to keep the game where it's at, and that's all you can ask for a guy out of the pen.
Dylan Dreiling sends a charge into this deep into right center field. McCants can't get to it. Dreiling hustling past second. Into third. What a ball game Dylan Dreiling putting together for Tennessee.
Roger Basely, the same swing, same pitch. Not quite the same result, but he's got the two hardest part of the cycle down. Beautiful left-handed swing. And dude, he was floating right here. I mean, looks like he's – I mean, he gets to third base so easy, and it was like maybe had a shot, you know, for in the park run. He's like, no, I'll take the triple.
First triple for him this season.
I would not think that. I mean, he's running. Make that look easy.
Only the third for the Vols. Robin Villeneuve. Two walks for Villeneuve on the night, including a bases loaded walk back in the first. Huge swing and a miss there.
You know, Coach Vitello just talked about, you know, gave Ben Hess a lot of respect and just the stuff that he has. It's not like it's a big drop-off to Aiden Mose. I mean, it's 94 fastball. That was an 87-mile-an-hour slider. So, guy's got really good stuff.
Ball gets away from Gassetti, but everyone will stay put with the count 2-2. The Crimson Tide have the infield in. Trying to keep this game where it is at 5-2. Dreiling at third, only one out. Got him swinging. Huge strikeout for Aiden Mose. Two gone in the Tennessee fifth.
Yeah, you saw the swing on the second strike, the on the slider, knowing that he'd probably go back to it. And that's what, you know, you need that as a pitcher when you get that guy on the third base. Less than two outs, you got to be able to get that strikeout. Mose goes right to the pitch that he wants it with, that slider, and puts him away.
Two away. Now Dean Curley, the SEC Freshman of the Week. Check swing, no swing, according to Alex Ransom, first base umpire. Currently 0 for 2 with a strikeout and a flyout. Mose just misses with a fastball. Now 2-1.
That's nasty.
Yeah, especially with the 2-0
right.
count.
Especially, too, the 1-0 pitch was just off the right plate, and that ball looked just like that same pitch. So he's going out there hacking, and, man, it just disappears.
Attacks again in the strike zone, 2-2.
Then he throws one inner third, and you think it's going to hit you, so you lose the hips a little bit. Aiden Mose just playing around with the slider.
A triple by Dreiling in this inning. Full count now to Curley. Payoff pitch. Just off the plate, and the inning continues with a walk to Curley. Fastball at 93.
Well, Roger, I don't know if you can miss by much. Gosh, if that miss, I mean, it's got to be outside, obviously, because it's crossing of the knees, but he already shown he could throw that pitch out there already. And a lot of times the umpires, if you know you show you could do it once and you do it again, they usually give it that second time.
And on the corners now, with two gone for Cannon Peebles. First pitch strike. Went to the slider. Quiet game so far for Peebles. Ground out to third and a strikeout looking, 0 for 2. Smothered in the dirt by Gassetti. Freshman All-America for NC State last year. Upstairs with the fastball to make it a two-ball, one-strike count on Peebles. He's been a 400 hitter with runners in scoring position this year. He's got Dreiling at third with two outs. Tennessee trying to cash in on the Dreiling triple. Another check at first at Curley. Runner goes for second. Smacked into center field for a base hit. Tennessee adds to its lead. Dreiling scores. Hustling to third base, Curley. The hit and run RBI single pays off for Tennessee. Cannon Peebles makes it 6-2, Big Orange.
That's back-to-back innings, two out. Lightning gets another RBI. That's a good piece of hitting. That ball's down. Looks, you see Matt Cassetti going to block that ball. So good piece of hitting, getting into the outfield. I like the way T.J. McCants plays that ball, though. Gets it back in quick to keep from getting two guys in the scoring position.
All of Tennessee's runs have scored with two outs in individual innings. Volunteers will go to its bench. Spot of Hunter Inslee is due up next. Now Dalton Bargo, transferred from Missouri to Tennessee, emerges as a pinch hitter. Swing and a miss at a fastball. Bargo homered over the weekend against Illinois. Sophomore out of Omaha. Blast against the Illini is second this year, a 364 average for Bargo. Moza gets in front, no balls, two strikes. The 0-2. Runner going as that one's hit foul. Foul by Bargo. This is a dangerous spot in the Tennessee order. He's in the nine spot. But some serious power waiting on deck in Christian Moore. Beyond that, Blake Burke and Billy Amick. Those are trying to make sure that they come to the plate with nobody on base in the sixth. Challenge him inside. No swing. Goes again. That's high for ball two. Gassetti will not throw to second. Now two in scoring position. Tennessee knocking on the door, and again with two outs, all six runs batted in this game. 3-for-7 at the plate.
I knew it was the last three. I didn't know it was all of them, but that's something you don't see. Matt Gassetti not throwing down. I don't think Justin LeBron was actually paying attention on that because they just gave that stolen base.
And Bargo really making Moza work for the final out.
Yeah, you got to give Bargo a lot of credit, right? You're sitting on the bench, and again, it's only five innings, but hey, by the way, you're going to go pinch hit. The guy's 94 with an 86, 87 mile an hour slider that's just been falling off the table.
Another guy with great experience coming in, even though he's just a sophomore, played in 43 games for Mizzou last year. Puts it in the gap in right center. Here come the Volunteers. Curley scores. Peebles right behind. Dalton Bargo, a pinch hit, two-run double, and Tennessee has made it an 8-2 lead in the fifth.
Roger, is this instilled in your head early? Games are won and lost with two outs, and we just saw the graphic. 4-for-8 now, 8 RBI for Tennessee. The offense is really good, and it's rolling, and they're comfortable, they're confident. And when you're playing like that and you know your pitcher is that good, deadly.
Now the top of the order is coming up to the plate with all the power, Moore, Burke, and Amick. Looks like that'll be it for Aiden Moza on the mound for the Crimson Tide. Gave up the two-run homer to Burke in the last inning, and then three-run rally for the Vols with two outs. Colson Buchanan will be coming in next for Alabama on the mound, with the Vols now in front by 6. SEC opener for Alabama and Tennessee on this Friday night, and right now the Volunteers have made it an 8-2 score, but it's been a few pitches away, Lance, from being maybe a 3-2 ball game at this point.
Yeah, I mean, you're talking, it's all with two outs, and so if you're able to make those pitches, it's a lot tighter ball game. But right now, Tennessee offense has been, you know, the bugaboo that Alabama's pitchers can't get out. I mean, they just can't finish the inning, and you know, it's not necessarily a lack of concentration. It's just maybe it's a little bit of nibbling here. Ben Hessel's doing that a little bit. But other than that, it's just a really good Tennessee lineup.
Now Colson Buchanan will try and shut it down as he's on for the Crimson Tide after he pitched in back-to-back days against Lipscomb. Not back-to-back games, but Saturday in game one of the doubleheader against the Bisons and then Sunday as well. Now he's going to take on the top of the Tennessee order with Christian Moore. Or hit by a pitch his last time up, 0-for-2, is the catalyst for this Tennessee offense. Sharply to shortstop. There's Justin LeBron, and that will close out the inning with the Volunteers strike for 3 runs in this top of the fifth to have a 6-run lead as we move to the bottom of the fifth. You're watching SEC Baseball Opening Weekend. Tennessee Volunteers and the Alabama Crimson Tide on the third Friday in March. Starting this 3-game set. And A.J. Causey gave up 2 runs in the first inning, but since then he's been cruising for the Volunteers. He has set down 7 in a row entering this frame.
Hey, I called it. I didn't think he'd be. And he is. And so props to him. And it's only now it's, what, 79 pitches? So done a nice job in that third and fourth inning to kind of minimize that and keep himself in the game. Now gets through the fifth, chance to get that win.
Bryce Eblen, bottom spot of the Crimson Tide order. Burke knocking it down, finally gets it to Causey.
Well, Roger, that's a play you practice at pitcher fielding practice. You're the first baseman intentionally bobbles the ball, and just to make sure that that's your job to do, you got to cover first, so it's just. Now, he doesn't obviously intentionally bobble it, but look, no questions asked. He doesn't even look. He's almost flipping it before because you just know, trust the pitcher's going to be there.
Causey, a good athlete as well.
Yeah.
So one gone, top of the order, back to the plate with Gage Miller. Strikeout and a walk so far for Miller. Crushes it high to right field. Tears all the way back to the warning track. We'll make the grab. Only not much wind to help that fly ball.
You know, past couple weekends, that ball's probably in the second deck of the Champions Plaza. Not tonight. That flag is not going anywhere.
Again, we were delayed at the start by rain here in Tuscaloosa. Game was scheduled to start at 6 p.m. Central. Got going just after 7, and all the rains kind of calmed everything down. Should be dry tomorrow and Sunday for the final two games of the series. A bunt laid down by McCants, third base side. Causey won't be in time, and it gets away. McCants will stay at first.
You play that drastic of a shift. You can't do that on T.J. McCants. And Causey made that actually closer than I thought he was. That's one of those where, as a pitcher, put that in your back pocket. You're probably not going to throw the guy out. You just risk a chance to move him up. Christian Moore played that geometry off the wall. Played that nicely.
McCants at first with two gone. Ian Petrutz takes the breaking ball for strike one. Solo homer back in the first, gave Alabama a 2-1 lead.
So that's what coaches will say. If you're going to be a guy that bunts with two outs, you kind of have to be looking to steal second so you can get in a scoring position, because now it's still going to take multiple hits or a ball in the gap to score you. So you lay down a two-out bunt, you probably need to look to steal second base.
Count even still, ball and a strike on Petrutz. And McCants, Alabama's best threat to run so far this season. The Crimson Tide, a perfect 15 of 15 stealing bases. And T.J. McCants tops on the team with 6 stolen bags. But for Alabama, just to get McCants on base, do anything to throw off the great rhythm we were seeing. For Causey, would sit down 9 in a row before that bunt single. That's a win here in this bottom of the fifth. End of the shift. Moore knocking it down offline. Everybody's safe.
Hey, Roger, this is the tough part of the shift. You can see Christian Miller, as he goes down, the feet kind of slip out from under you. And he's far enough into the outfield that it's now he feels like he has to rush the throw. Blake Burke not able to come up with it. And now you got a little two-out lightning for Alabama. But still, you got to be able to get that big hit. Not going to get it all back once, but they showed against Southern Miss. They were down 9-2, and they kept fighting back. This is a team that will fight for Coach Vaughn.
Yeah, down 9-2 on Tuesday night in the ninth inning, and the big hit was a 3-run triple by Evan Slight, who comes to the plate now.
That's what I was about to say. What better time for your captain to come up and step up and get that big old knock?
By the way, that was ruled an infield or a base hit for Petrutz. Just telling you what the score said. Lance looked at me like I was crazy. Now 0-2 on Slight. Causey just one walk compared to 6 strikeouts. He's already struck out Evan Slight once. Stayed just away with a fastball. Slight takes a called third strike on a fastball from Causey. He's got 7 strikeouts. He's got the Volunteers up by 6. When we come back, we'll chat with the head coach of the Crimson Tide, Rob Vaughn. Top of the 6th in Tuscaloosa, Roger and Lance upstairs, joined by the head coach of the Crimson Tide, Rob Vaughn, in the Alabama dugout. And coach, you always talk about punching analogies for your baseball team. Tennessee punch first with a run in the top of the first. What'd you like about the response? Punching right back with those back-to-back home runs by McCants and Petrutz.
Yeah, I like our at-bats. We've had some tough at-bats. Causey's good, man. It's the changeup's really good. And, you know, he just throws a ton of strikes. That's really the story of the game so far, is free bases. You know, I think they've given us 1. We've given them, I think, 7, I think, right now. So they've taken advantage of some mistakes. But I like the at-bats. We've taken pretty good swings and kind of had some hard luck outs. And you know, we just stay in the fight here. Hopefully Buck can give us a 0 here, and we'll get right back in this thing.
Well, Coach, how would you assess Ben Hess's outing? Obviously, there's some good positives because there's a lot of strikeouts, but like you mentioned, the free passes, just too many of those.
Yeah, he just didn't land the breaking ball quite enough, you know, and he just gotten some deep counts, gotten some 0-2 counts early, and then 0-2 turned into 3-2, and then he'd either miss with it or they ran off some pitches, so it just drove his pitch count up a little bit. He really threw the ball pretty well, just too many deep counts, and I think that's what gets him out of the game early. And against a tough lineup, you know, it's a lot more comfortable to hit when you're ahead in the count a lot versus being behind. That's one thing Causey's done a really good job of. I feel like, you know, we step in there and it feels like it's 0-2 every time. And that's just part of baseball. We got to lock horns with him and try to get him out of the game and string some good ones together.
Coach, thank you for your time. Thank you for joining us.
Thanks, guys. Roll Tide.
It's the head coach of the Crimson Tide, Rob Vaughn. First year in Tuscaloosa, first SEC game, and he's matched up against Tony Vitello, the Tennessee Volunteers. Blake Burke, two-run homer last time up. Pokes it up the middle, but shaded over was LeBron. Throw out Burke to start the sixth inning.
Well, you don't see many of those at bats by Burke, just giving himself up. That was one of those just, you know, that's a two-out swing. I mean, a two-strike swing he has with one strike. You know he's going to be frustrated himself right there, but a good pitch right there by Buchanan getting that out.
Billy Amick next up. Couple of walks and a ground out to short for him tonight. Two ground ball outs to short, and due so far by Buchanan for the Crimson Tide. Cannon's 0-2. Trying to hit the bottom of the zone now on even count.
Yeah, you got a vast difference of what you see now stuff-wise. Go, two guys pumping, you know, mid to upper 90s, and now Buchanan comes in and it's 84 to 87.
Base hit to left for Billy Amick.
A lot of cutters. You know, not many balls just coming in there straight.
Morris Tears, the cleanup batter, 0 for 3 in this ball game tonight. Cannon misses high to start this at bat. Great start to the year for Tears. A 16-game hitting streak coming into tonight. He's reached base safely in all 17 games for the Vols. Crushes that high to straightaway center. McCants all the way back, and it's gone. Guevara's Tears with a two-run homer. Give him six homers this year for the Vols, and now Tennessee with a 10-2 lead. Seventeen-game hitting streak, Guevara's Tears.
I was about to say, that's one way to extend the hitting streak, right? 0 for 3, have looked pretty bad at the plate. Get you a pitch to hit and absolutely crush it out to center field. Again, Roger, that plays 390. It seems like it's always played a little bit more like 410. But the one McCants hit, that one right there, that's just an easy swing. And you don't see many balls fly out there. And it's flying out to center tonight.
It's got it at 413 off the bat. Well, the base is empty for Dylan Dreiling, who's already had a two-run home run as well as a triple.
It was one of those off the bat. I thought it was going the way T.J. McCann, so he kept looking like he was going to try to, and I was like, well, maybe it wasn't hit all, as well as it sounded and it looked.
Another one hit high to center. Kantz will put away this one for out number two. Cannon trying to close down this inning. Robin Villeneuve, Tennessee designated hitter, started the scoring way back in the first inning with a bases loaded walk.
39, Sam Mitchell warming up for Alabama. 39, Mitchell warming up in the Alabama bullpen.
Buchanan gets him from 1-2 as he's with the Crimson Tide after 2 years at Wofford. He transferred 20 games, 18 starts, so he's somebody that can provide some length on the mound for the Crimson Tide. And again, you're getting to a spot where you need that, trying to get ready for the rest of the weekend.
Right, that's you're not going to bring in guys that you expect to be in the tight ball games now. You're down 10-2, so you're just hoping the guys can keep the game close and allow your offense to fight back.
Miller had to wait an extra beat. Makes the throw to close out this top of the sixth inning, but the big bang for Tennessee, courtesy of Kavaris Tears, making it 10-2, Big Orange.
Tennessee came into this game second in the country in home runs with 49. They're trying to add. It says, hey, let's get that to 52. 10-2 in Tuscaloosa.
Fans enjoying this one so far. 10-2 Tennessee in the opening game, not only of this series, but of SEC baseball here in 2024. First pitch to William Hammeter from Causey, who again has been rolling. He got into a little bit of trouble last inning. Bunt single by McCants, single as well by Petrutz, but got out of it. He's had four scoreless innings in a row. Amateur to shortstop. There's Curley with a bobble. And he'll still get the out. Defense has been a talking point for Curley at shortstop. Already four errors this year as a freshman.
Well, I mean, that just showed right there. That's no panic, right? So he knows he bobbles the ball, but picks it up, doesn't panic, and has a strong throw. Again, that's game speed. You got to know the runner. See the bobble and then perfect throw.
One gone, Mac Gassetti, the Crimson Tide catcher. Just past the mound. Here's Curley again. Barehanded. Got him. Outstanding work by Tennessee shortstop Dean Curley.
Roger, he heard you. He said, the defense is what? Defense is a little sketchy? No, he said barehand that. He's only got one shot, right? It is the barehand. And he makes the play. I love the reaction. I don't know if we're going to get it from the Dylan Call. AJ calls. He sees that and he's like, that is unbelievable. Throws the fist bump. And when you see guys pulling for each other like that, I love that.
Two gone, Will Hodo. Crimson Tide first baseman has one of the six hits for Alabama tonight.
And you remember in Coach Vitello's interview, he was like, you know, when guys, he said, I love to see the guys pick up Causey because he's been out there just battling, doing his job. And so seeing already two plays right there, picking him up.
Chemistry's been really good on this Tennessee team. And again, it's tougher to build up chemistry now. The transfer portal, so many new faces like Causey to this Tennessee team. Curley, just a freshman.
You want to know what helps chemistry?
Winning.
17-1.
An opportunity tonight to get win number 17 in a row. Second longest active streak right now in D1 baseball behind A&M. Mm-hmm. Who tonight
took the L.
So Tennessee with a win would ride it to 17 straight. Best in college baseball. I was waiting for a scoreboard.
Well.
1-2 to Hodo.
There's been some upsets in the SEC tonight. Or at least brewing, I guess you'd say.
100th pitch of the game for Causey. Is 2-2. Got him looking. Causey with his eighth strikeout through six strong innings tonight against Alabama.
that might be his last pitch of the night, but he made his last pitch a good one. This is that front door kind of sinker they were talking about, where the hit at the hip, back over the middle.
Colson Buchanan on the mound for Alabama, trying to slow down a Tennessee offense that has scored 9 runs over the last 4 innings. Bottom third of the order due up here, starting with the shortstop, Dean Curley.
Well, obviously, Roger, we knew both these offenses were good. And Tennessee obviously statistically had the better thing. And mark of a good offense is really putting pressure every inning. I mean, Bama's had base runners, and they put some pressure. But Tennessee scoring runs every inning outside of the second. So, and not just runs, putting up some crooked numbers.
All but 2 of the runs have been scored with 2 outs as well for the Volunteers. The last inning, the 2-run homer by Tears was with only 1 out. Full count to Curley. All Southern Conference second team honors for Buchanan last year with Wofford. 5-4, a 5.22 ERA. Led the Terriers strikeouts, innings pitched, and starts as a sophomore. Line drive to right. There's Slide with a slide and a catch. Opening day of SEC baseball here in 2024. Tennessee with the lead against Alabama. Here are other scores around the league. And like we mentioned, the winning streak comes to a close for Texas A&M against a very good Gators ball club.
You look at that Mississippi State. I mean, people were down on Mississippi State. At home with the Dude. 10-4 over LSU right now.
Arkansas looking just fine against Missouri. Razorbacks.
Hagan Smith on Friday night.
Yeah.
Get out of there.
With a very good lineup as well. Arkansas will be making the trip here to Tuscaloosa coming up in mid-April. Cannon Peebles. Lifted high to left field. 2 gone. Tomorrow afternoon, we'll have Missouri's annual Black and Gold Spring Football game for, excuse me, the SEC Network Baseball Game of the Week is game 2 of the 3-game series between number 2, LSU and Mississippi State at Tutti Noble Field. Coverage will start tomorrow afternoon, 5 Eastern, 4 Central. Also, make sure you check out Spring Football for Missouri. Dalton Bargo, 2-run double back in the 5th inning. Came off the bench, really worked a great at-bat. One of the key moments in this game for Tennessee. Balls have scored the last 4 innings. Last time held off the scoreboard back in the 2nd when Hess had a 1-2-3 frame. Just past the shift into right field. Bargo with another hit for the Vols.
I don't know how he snuck that one in. That might be one if you're the first baseman Will Hodo, you might want to go after that and just trust the fact that, hey, if I can go get it, my pitcher will be there.
Alabama trying to keep this game right where it is. Tennessee at the moment up 8. It is SEC play. The 10-run run rule is in effect. And now you got one of the better power hitters in the Tennessee order, Christian Moore, at the plate. Never want to start a weekend with a run rule. or relatively quieted tonight. 0-for-3 was hit by a pitch by Hess back in the fourth. He was the last batter that Crimson Tide starter Ben Hess faced.
I think at that point it was a 3-2 game, and he gets two quick outs, and then he hits more. They go to the bullpen, next batter, Jack. And that kind of is the part that kind of started opening the floodgates, and then Tennessee scoring two runs that inning, three, and then two more.
Two to Christian Moore. Tennessee, a lot of patient at bats tonight, seeing it once again with Christian Moore at the plate. Two. Got him looking strike three. That'll close out the top of the seventh as Tennessee does not score for the first time since the second. Seventh inning stretch time, 10-2 Volunteers.
Yeah, SEC baseball is really kind of the pinnacle of college baseball.
You got the top arms, you got the top bats. You know, everybody competes at the highest level.
It's a gauntlet. There is not an easy weekend. You know, once we roll into conference play, that's what's so awesome about this conference. Anybody can beat anybody.
30-game journey begins tonight. Here's a look at the tough schedule awaiting Tony Vitello and the Tennessee Volunteers. Starting off with a tough road trip against the 14th-ranked team in the country, Alabama. Causey has been working really well on the mound, but just SEC baseball, the ups and the downs you see make it really, really tough all throughout the year to sustain winning, which Tony Vitello's done, especially that group 2 years ago in 2022. But even that group lost a series on the road to Kentucky.
Yeah, it's about being consistent, right? Because you're going to have your ups, your downs, and you can't let one game affect the next one. I got to apologize to Mr. Causey. I thought it was his last pitch, but he said, no, I'm going to go back out there for the seventh and keep going. And but it's fun, though, right? Because you're going to unbelievable places. Like, so we talk about the top, you know, ranked teams in the country and a lot of them in SEC, but like, it's also parks. Like when you talk about Baum Stadium at Arkansas, just having 12,000 and when they call the Hogs, like it's just a cool atmosphere to be in at a lot of these SEC fields.
Close play, but LeBron thrown out by Causey to start the Alabama seventh inning. Crimson Tide know all about a tough schedule coming up. A lot of the tough matchups, though, for Alabama at least are at home, most notably Arkansas, Texas A&M.
Yeah, you're right. And that's, again, if you can say you'd like, hey, it's better to play them at home, right? So you're not saying it's easier, but it's just you'd rather play them at home than there.
I mean, three top five teams right now will be coming here to Tuscaloosa. First half of SEC play. And LSU in May,
yeah,
but later on, yeah. Yes.
So if you're an Alabama season, you know, go get your season tickets. Go buy some tickets for the games because that's as good a home schedule as you're going to see.
Eblen waves that and misses that one. 1-1. Bottom of the order, Eblen 1-for-2 in this game for the Crimson Tide against Causey. Barrels that high and deep to left field. Dreiling on the warning track will make the grab. Causey a chance to get through seven innings.
Would have never thought that.
Back-to-back home runs he gave up back in the first since then. Crimson Tide not much against him. Now Tony Vitello will be coming out of the Tennessee dugout. That will be it. 111 pitches, but what an effort for A.J. Causey on the mound for the Vols.
Yeah, outstanding effort. Look at those pitch counts. I mean, it was, you're thinking in the second inning, he's like, there's no way he's going to be here. But look at those, 10, 14, 14, 10, and a 9.
That second inning got out of a bases-loaded jam against Tennessee by striking out T.J. McCants, who homered against him earlier. Once again, a solid start for Causey on a Friday night for the Volunteers. Tennessee bullpen will take over next. Alabama native A.J. Causey returns to his home state facing the Crimson Tide. He got better as this night went along here in Tuscaloosa.
He had the mark of a good pitcher. If you don't get to him early, and Alabama did the two, but he settled in and put up zeros the rest of the way. Causey was unbelievable. That to me was his best pitch. The fastball in, hitter gives up on it. He's got so much movement. And again, when the fastball and the changeup look exactly alike, tough combination.
Solid start for Causey. Now the bullpen will take over with Andrew Benke, sophomore lefty out of Nashville. Through two scoreless innings, had three strikeouts his last time out against Illinois.
Well, you're seeing Benke come in. I mean, here's a spot of Alabama's lineup. Obviously, Miller's right-handed, but it's four lefties right after that. So five of the next six hitters will be left-handed, and that's what you got to see. You got to see what your lefty guys ready to go.
Miller skies it high to right field. Inning will come to a close. 1-2-3 go the Crimson Tide in the seventh. Move on to the eighth. It's still Tennessee with a 10-2 lead on opening night of SEC play. Opening game of this three-game series between the Crimson Tide and the Volunteers. Night one so far going to Tennessee, as Alabama will try and keep this game right where it is with Pierce George on the mound. The native of Austin, Texas, transferred to Alabama from the University of Texas, and Lance, he throws hard.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. When all of a sudden you're behind home plate and there's 10 guys that they're like, they just look different, right? They're called scouts. And right when Pierce George stepped on the mound, they just started coming out of the woodworks from down the line, everything. They're grabbing their radar guns because, yes, Roger, Pierce George, it's everything up to 101, I think he's already hit this year. So it's a good fastball. It's a good slider. But what it is it's not a lot of experience yet. And so that's what Alabama coaches are trying to do. JJ, the pitching coach, said, you know, they just got to get him innings and trying to pick and choose their spots because it's real stuff. There's no doubt about it.
Scouts keeping an eye on guys like George because of what's coming up later on this summer with the draft. And we take a look at some of the top prospects we're going to get to see. Well, we've already seen Ben Hess and Billy Amick, but Drew Beam will be on the mound, the starting pitcher for the Vols tomorrow.
And I like how Coach Vitello does it. Like, because he knows what he's going to get from Drew Beam on Saturday. So you go, hey, what we can do, piece it together on Friday night, and then go, hey, now we have our guy. We can expect a good, you know, 6 to 7 innings out of Drew Beam, and then figure out what you got on Sunday. So I like him on Saturday. Especially if A.J. Causey keeps throwing the way he has.
Right.
Makes anybody look smart.
Blake Burke will be the first man to the plate for the Volunteers in the top of the eighth inning. Just another night for Burke. 2-for-4, 2-run homer, 2 runs batted in, scored a pair of runs as well. In the second spot of that Tennessee batting order.
Yeah, 100. There you go. You're about to see.
Fouled away at 99.
Took a little something off.
What finesse from George.
I want to see another one. You know it's coming. Here you go. Hit it.
The 0-2. Fastball smacked the other way at 101 miles per hour. Burke fights it off in the left field. And he's got a leadoff single to start this eighth inning.
Number 11, Billy Amick.
Burke at first base. One of the best base running threats Tennessee has as well. He and Kavaris Tears, even with three stolen bags for Tennessee this year. Billy Amick next up. First pitch at 98 from George. Amick singled last time up, setting up the two-run homer by Tears. Fastball in the dirt, we'll even the count. So George spent last year as a freshman at Texas, two innings across three appearances for the Longhorns, then transfers to Alabama. He's a standout at Lake Travis High School in Austin. Into center field for a base hit. Amick with his second hit of the night. Burke showing off his speed to third base on the single by Billy Amick. Middle of the corners with nobody out for Tennessee. Clean up batter Kavaris Tears coming up next. Tricky spot for George to come in facing Burke, Amick, now Tears.
Yeah, it's a tough spot when you really think about you're coming in and the guy's trying to feel himself out and trying to feel part of the game, and you make a good pitch, guy gets jammed, shoots one way. Then all of a sudden something else happens, and now you got two guys on, and there's still nobody out.
99 Austin Morris up in the Alabama bullpen. 99 Morris up for Alabama.
Burke got it going with a single. Followed by a single by Amick. This gets away from Gassetti. Here comes Burke. Tennessee 11, Alabama 2.
You always need a little help sometimes, and sometimes it's just hard to catch that ball. It's so hard down, you don't know if it's going to bounce. It's kind of the in-between, and Amick tries to sneak that extra base. Nice job right there by Gassetti, going to get that ball and making a strong throw to third base.
Tears still at the plate and the 3-0. Four-pitch walk to Tears. To the wild pitch brought in Burke to make it a 9-run Tennessee advantage. Volunteers 11 runs, 11 hits. Dreiling, opposite field to left. Grab made by Petrutz. That'll be the second out here in the eighth. So Alabama needing to get this final out to keep it at a 9-run score. Otherwise, they'll be down to their final three outs in the bottom of the eighth with a run rule.
You like the run rule? Last year was the first year where all conference games, 10-run rule after seven.
I'm such a traditionalist, so I have to say no kind of by default, but at times I think it has been useful.
I mean, I think when you look in a game like this, it's not, you know, it is, 10 runs is out of hand, but it's not like it's a 17 run. You know, some of those games do get where it's like, you know, nobody wants to be out there, you know, thinking about pitching a guy that hasn't pitched yet, or maybe even thinking of a position player. So I like it for that. But still, like, games like this, it's still competitive. You know, they're putting competitive at-bats together.
Villeneuve down to his last strike at 0-2.
You could pitch 101 down in the zone and back it up with that. It's going to be unhittable. It's just a matter of really just getting innings, getting outings out there where every time you go out there and think about, you got to be able to have that stuff and compete like that.
George got him swinging, and that'll close out the inning. One run does score, but it's still a 9-run ball game thanks to George. First of three games this weekend between Tennessee and Alabama to start SEC baseball here in 2024. So far, so good for the Volunteers after Alabama led 2-1 in the first inning thanks to back-to-back home runs by the two men that are due up first for the Crimson Tide here in this bottom of the eighth inning. T.J. McCants will get it going against the Tennessee lefty, Andrew Benke. Solo home run for McCants, his seventh of the season, also added a bunt single against the shift back in the fifth. Obviously a tough night for the Crimson Tide with the way Tennessee has grown the lead. An opportunity to bounce back tomorrow. You know it's going to be against one of Tennessee's best in Drew Beam. Greg Ferone, the lefty, will get the ball for the Crimson Tide.
I was about to say, I think Bama still feels good about Ferone, especially the way he threw last outing against Lipscomb. I know it's a totally different lineup, but the big lefty.
That hit McCants. He's aboard to start the eighth inning.
Yeah, for Benke, this is a spot where you want to show your coach, look, I'm coming in facing nothing but lefties, showing that I could get the big, tough lefties out. And he's trying to go in. Looks like he gets him right above that wrist. The only question was, did he check his swing? And home plate umpire Christopher Griffin asked third base Kevin Elzey, and he said, nope, didn't check it.
Crimson Tide have been hit by a lot of pitches this season. That's now the 41st time Alabama's been hit by a pitch in what's now only 18 games. LSU leads the way. That's still a lot in a short amount of time.
You got two guys, Gage Miller and Matt Cassetti, have 17 combined, so that's a big chunk of them.
Is that just their approach to the plate or, like, really at the front of the box?
Well, I mean, I know Gage Miller's all over the plate, and a lot of times when guys do that, you're like, as a pitcher, I can bust them in, right? And sometimes guys get on the plate because they want to dare you to go in because their hands are quick enough. Sometimes they just can't get to the outside pitch, so it's just – and so when guys try to go in, if you miss, you know, college guys necessarily don't have the – consistency of the delivery to really know that, hey, I'm going to throw that pitch in there for a strike, and you miss just a little bit and the guy's on top of the plate, you're going to hit him.
Petrutz homered back in the first. Infield single back in the fifth inning. Check on McCants at first base. Gets away from the catcher, Peebles to the backstop. McCants will take second easily. Benke will be joined on the mound by all of his infielders, as well as the pitching coach for the Volunteers, Frank Anderson.
I think that was a fiery message. It's one of those where, hey, you walk out there, say what you got to say, and get out of there. Look, it's an 11-2 ball game. Go out there, you know, your job. You're coming here to get lefties. Let's go ahead, attack the zone. The stuff is good. It's just a matter about being in the zone.
Three and one on Petrutz with first base open, nobody out. Excuse me, check swing, foul ball, 3-2. went around, according to home plate umpire Christopher Griffith. Strike three.
28, Aaron Combs warming up for Tennessee. 28, Combs warming up for Tennessee bullpen.
Well, that meeting, it worked. Go out there, throw strikes. You guys just trust your stuff. I mean, it's a tough angle. Throws the ball across his body, so as a left-hander, you really feel like it's hard to stay close, keep that front side close, because it feels like the ball's coming right at you, and you're able to put that slider like you just did on the other side of part of the plate.
Hit batter into Wild Kids for Benkey. He comes back with a strikeout of Petrutz, now facing Evan Slight. Crimson Tide right fielder has been 0-for-3 in this game. Falling behind once again. He has been solid in his time on the mound. 4 scoreless outings so far this season. Set a career high with 5 strikeouts and 2 2/3 innings in his season debut against UNC Asheville. Huge swing and a miss on an 89 mile an hour fastball. Third strike, fastball at 90.
Well, the left on left matchup, it's just tough because, again, you don't see many left-handed pitchers, and especially quality left-handed pitchers, coming up through the little leagues in middle school and high school type stuff. So when you get a guy like this, again, it's the stuff is not great. I mean, it's 90, 89 to 91, but still, you can spot up that, especially throwing across your body. You'll get a lot of outs.
Two gone in the Crimson Tide eighth inning. McCants at second base. Now Mason Swinney, pinch hitter for Alabama. That ran inside to Swinney. Sophomore out of Phil Campbell, Alabama, entered off the bench and recorded a hit against Southern Miss back on March 12th. We'll get some extra time to think about the next pitch as Tony Vitello has come out of the Tennessee dugout. And a call to the bullpen will be made for the Volunteers. Tennessee trying to hang on to this 9-run advantage. It'll be Combs coming in for the Volunteers. Aaron Combs will take over here in this bottom of the eighth in Tuscaloosa. Opening night in SEC baseball in the first inning after the Vols led 1-0. It was TJ McCants tying the game with a solo home run to center field. Game was tied for only a few pitches. Ian Petrutz next up powers out a solo homer to make it 2-1 Crimson Tide.
But what you did see, Roger, is AJ Causey. He settles down. Middle part of the game, it's 0-0. Came in with a 30-3 strikeout to walk ratio, and all he does is add 8 more punch outs. The changeup right there was working really good. Curveball, slider, he's got it all.
Volunteers would fight their way back thanks to the long ball. Dylan Dreiling with a 2-run shot in the third that pushed Tennessee back in front. 3-2 score. And then Blake Burke just does what Blake Burke always does, hits home runs. He is now up to 7 this season, getting closer to that Tennessee school record for career home runs. Blake Burke with a Burke bomb is 7th of the year. I think the Volunteers would add another one as well. As Tennessee's built up an 11-2 lead, now gives the baseball to Aaron Combs, the redshirt sophomore out of Sarasota, Florida. Transferred to Tennessee from the College of Central Florida. Facing Swinney with a count 2-1. Combs started for the Sunday against Illinois before Nate Snead would close out the final 6 innings of that game. So Combs, a guy they can use in a lot of different roles.
He's a guy that's going to come right at you, 88 to 92. He's got all the pitches, the curveball, the slider, the change. But, I mean, this is one where he's in attack mode.
career-high 3 innings in that start against the Illini. McCants at second with 2 gone. And it's a walk to put Swinney aboard. And he continues for Mac Gassetti, the Crimson Tide catcher. 0 for 3 in this game tonight. Comes 4-0 out of the Tennessee bullpen last year, an ERA at 3. Prior to that, College of Central Florida in 2021 started his career at Coastal Carolina. Third baseline finally fell. Two on, but 2 gone for the Crimson Tide. Combs just missing. Got him swinging. Aaron Combs with the strikeout closes out the eighth as Alabama does not score. Ninth inning coming up. It's still the Vols by 9.
I told you, he's got the fastball. It actually got up to 93, but it's the big overhand hook right here that has Mac Gassetti out in front. Finishes him off.
Reach the top of the ninth in Tuscaloosa with the Volunteers up 11-2 against the Crimson Tide in game one of the series, the SEC opener. 11 runs on 11 hits for Tennessee, stayed patient with some walks and some huge home runs, helping Tennessee grow this advantage to 9. First to the plate, Dean Curley, reigning SEC Player of the Week. Shortstop for the Volunteers, 0 for 3 with a walk. Still Pierce George on the mound, firing in fastballs. That last one, 99 miles per hour. I think the best we've seen, Lance, is 101.
You know, a lot of the times you see guys that throw that hard. Gun checkers, right? After every throw, just check the scoreboard just to see what it was. Pierce George just grabs the ball, gets on the rubber. He goes, I know I throw hard. I don't have to look back there.
Reminds you of Ben Joyce 2 years ago with Tennessee. 1-2 to Curley. Lifted high into the gap in left center field for a base hit. All the way to the dugout fence or the bullpen fence for Tennessee. Curley will cruise into second with a double. Rob Vaughn coaching his first game in the SEC for the Crimson Tide. He is being faced by Tony Vitello, somebody he has known for going on 20 years. Coach Vitello was an assistant coach at Missouri, tried to recruit Rob Vaughn, of course, an outstanding high school prospect out of the state of Texas. Got to see him at a showcase and followed Rob to his truck and saw Texas A&M bumper stickers. Thought, okay, might not be coming to Missouri. But what turned out was really good recruiting done by somebody that's now on the Tennessee staff. The video coordinator, Sean McCann, was recruiting him for Kansas State. That's eventually where Rob Vaughn signed. Tony talked about how he wanted to kind of slow play it with Vaughn. He said if Missouri showed interest in some Texas prospects, so that one's popped up. quickly, the Texas schools would be recruiting them, and then there'd be no chance. Say Texas A&M would come in, grab him right away. So we kind of slow played it with Rob Vaughn a little bit, but McCann, his recruiting paid off. Got Rob to Kansas State. Now all of them reunited here this weekend in Tuscaloosa. It's really a small world in college baseball.
It really is, and Coach Vaughn had tons of good things to say about Coach Vitello and just how he approached that. And Coach Vitello said, he goes, I just got lazy. He goes, I just got lazy. I saw the bumper sticker. Rob said, he goes, it says Texas A&M baseball. He goes, but I mean, that's where my dad played. It's where, that's just where his dream school was. And Coach Vitello said, he goes, yeah, I got lazy. And Coach McCann, he didn't. He stayed on him. And Coach Vaughn told me the story. He goes, he sent him a 70-something straight days, something in the mail. Like, that's how you recruited back in the day. It was, you would get something in the mail, and he said it was reasons to come to Kansas State. And it was 70-some days in a row, and he said something he took to Maryland about, hey, reasons to be a Terp. He said he would send that out there, whether it was a handwritten note or something, whether something that a graphic that came from the athletic department. But he said he loved that about it, and he goes, that just won him over.
Chapman strikes out in his first at-bat tonight. Coach Vitello has the Vols playing really well here early in this 2024 season, trying to win tonight to get to 17 games, which would be the longest in college baseball, with the loss by A&M earlier. Longest was back in 2022, 23 games. I believe was snapped right before Alabama came to town. Mm-hmm. Snapped by
Tennessee Tech.
Tennessee Tech.
Wooden bat game.
At
I remember
Smoky
that.
Stadium.
And it was one of those going, man, when he saw that schedule, and as you got 23 games running, we have to go, we're doing a what? A wooden bat game? And yeah, they lost that game. And then Alabama goes to Knoxville and wins the first game of that series.
Tennessee, prior to that, had been unbeaten in SEC play. Moore grounds that one to short. For the out to close out the inning, Pierce George, a scoreless top of the ninth against the Volunteers. Last chance for the Crimson Tide coming up next. Of course, a lot of SEC teams in the top 25 as we start conference play 5 weeks into the season, and maybe some differences between the top 25 and the RPI, except for the Razorbacks.
Yeah, well, what you're seeing is you haven't started conference series. So now once conference starts and everybody starts playing guys with those kind of records, you're going to see all of those RPIs go the other way, a lot closer to their rankings.
Start this bottom of the ninth inning. Still Combs working on the mound. A walk and a strikeout to close out the eighth inning. Facing the bottom third of the Crimson Tide batting order. Hodo, Portera, and Eblen all due to the plate. It all starts with Will Hodo. Two to Hodo, who's powered out 4 home runs this season for the Crimson Tide, matching his total from a year ago when he was at times in the starting lineup as the DH. Playing time faded a little bit as the year went along last year. He's somebody that's got some serious power and has taken over as the everyday first baseman for Alabama. Junior out of Waynesboro, Mississippi, had a lot of friends and family watching, only 30 minutes from home in Hattiesburg on Tuesday. Crushes that to center. Backing up on it is Tears to the wall, and it's gone. Will Hodo muscles out his 5th home run of the season here in the bottom of the ninth.
Roger, I think you said it best, muscles. I mean, this is a guy that if you say, how do you want to build a hitter? He's that guy. Every bit of 6'4" and just rock solid and lets that ball travel, hits it deep. And, I mean, that's ball's flying out to center. I mean, Again, that's not the ones we've seen earlier, the T.J. McCanns, but just getting enough done. And these are the kind of at-bats, right? Bama was down 9-2 to Southern Miss. They fight back, they fight back. But it's these at-bats that you just don't give away that allow you to maybe, you know, get that hot streak instead of just going up there, well, it's 11-2, you know, who cares, giving away an at-bat, and then that starts a slump. So you got to like the approach right there by Will Hodo.
Another Will into the plate, Will Portera. Came off the bench. Part of some of the defensive changes for the Crimson Tide. And again, Rob Vaughn, when he talked to this earlier in the game, he likes still a lot of the approach of the at-bats. He really has talked about, yes, 15-2 start, great start to the season. Really haven't had that clunker of a game just yet, a midweek where maybe you weren't ready for an opponent, didn't feel that way about the loss to Southern Miss earlier in the week. And even though tonight Tennessee was able to do some good things, you've still seen the fight from Alabama.
Well, right. I mean, you take the two losses, right? You have one to DBU where it was extra inning ball game, so you're in it. Then you have the loss to Southern Miss. Well, it looked doom and gloom, right? But then all of a sudden you have one out and tying runs walking to the plate. So in any part of the ball game, you still got to feel good about yourself because, hey, we fought to the end.
Rick Anderson will chat with Combs.
You know, last time he went out there, it turned out to be a pretty good meeting. Struck out the next two guys.
That was for Andrew Benke an inning ago. It's going to be fascinating to see all the talent, of course. Frank Anderson's coach throughout his career speaks for itself, but especially here in Tennessee, the impact it makes in Major League Baseball coming up will certainly be fun to watch. Blake Tidwell, if any of you were watching the New York Mets earlier, he's been working well in some spring training games for the Mets, being one of the aces of the Tennessee staff 2 years ago.
Who did Dolander go to? What?
I'll have to look it up, but he's, again, off to a solid start as well. Ball's well represented in the MLB draft. Zavalin will pop up the first pitch he sees. And the grab made by Tennessee's Dreiling. Jay Stillander went to the Rockies with a number 9 overall pick last year. First rounder. Portera will take second base. Gage Miller is at the plate. Game hitting streak on the line for Miller. 0-for-3 with a walk in this one. Really being a great table setter at the top of the order, along with T.J. McCants, who's already homered in this ball game. Pop foul, 1-2. Going to be watching tomorrow, game 2 of the series, starting at 8 Eastern, 7 Central. Make sure you're watching it right away. In the bottom of the first inning for that first at-bat, Gage Miller against Drew Beam. After backing up on this, Amick will throw out Miller. Last chance for the Crimson Tide will be T.J. McCants. Hitting streak will come to a close for Miller. Home run, a bunt single hit by a pitch, McCants tonight. Yeah. Waved and missed that breaking ball. Now Alabama down to its final strike. Combs strikes out McCann swinging, and the ball game is over. Tennessee starts SEC play with a dominant 11-3 win against Alabama, and now the Volunteers with 17 straight victories, the longest active winning streak in college baseball.
Boy, Roger, offense as good as advertised, 12 hits, half of them extra base hits. I mean, they did it by walks. They got a lot of free pass. They earned it, and then got the starting pitching they needed. After falling in a hole, A.J. Causey throws up six straight zeros. Let's get it done.
Crimson Tide will try to regroup for the final two games of the series, but Tennessee a strong start, 11-3. So for Lance Cormier and our entire... We're saying so long from Tuscaloosa, where the final score is Tennessee 11, Alabama 3. Thanks for joining us here on the SEC Network.